Welcome to session number 28. Today's presentation has been prepared by Cristof, so I'm very happy and delighted to hand it over to him.
Ta-da! All righty. So we'll begin a little heavy. No, actually not. It's just I see in my script, I see the word World War II, and I feel like, oh, it's going to be a heavy issue. But it's just a time marker. So because since the end of World War II, we've seen about 75-year-long stretch, maybe. Yeah, it's 75? I think so. Of time which, at least among the industrialized nations, has not seen any military war. And one of the main reasons that scientists agree on is that there has been a good time of international communication, cooperation, trade, and all of that. Of course, the internet has helped in the last, 25 years to also connect people. And that's created prosperity. There was job, food, resources, and actually a quick glance into history books allows us to see that as long as the people, the common people, were given resources, capital, education, they basically stayed busy with themselves, and nobody kind of thought of war or anything like that. Obviously, that's not new information, and obviously many a leader knows those, but not all. And for example, after World War I, going back another 20 years, 25 years, the losing countries were among them Germany and who else was, Germany, again, probably the big one, the big loser. They were revengefully enslaved to pay reparations, which if they had been kept up, they would have been kept up, for 75 years or 100 years, like for several generations, and would have kept them poor. And instead of leading to peace and control and everything, we know what that led to. It led to Hitler and World War II and all of that. After World War II, the situation was much different. Like there was the Marshall Plan, the losing countries, Italy, Japan, Germany, were given basically resources to rebuild their countries. And that's been the basis of the prosperity that has followed, at least among those industrialized nations. So today's topic is leadership for the people. And this, I was with this whole, the riots that had been going on for the last few weeks, and is it months now, by now? And of course, the inequalities that have been going on for much, much longer than that in this country, I was thinking, like, so what should one do in order to create peace, not just within ourselves, that's what we're working in meditation, obviously, but also maybe we can do something in the physical world here and there, and or what we can do, but also I first thought, okay, there's people in charge, there's people in power who could do something, and we know from these examples, with the Marshall Plan after World War II, that this way of leading a country or this way of leading between countries could also probably work within a country, within a state, within a county, within a municipality, and all of that is bloodless. That's the big important thing. No one needs to be oppressed. Nothing needs to be conquered. No religious sacrifices need to be made in order to appease a god or something like that. We can just have basically all prosperity and security. And in this kind of thought pattern, I skimmed through a book called In the Buddha's Word, Words, an anthology of discourses from the Pali Canon by Bhikkhu Bodhi. And it's basically a collection of sort of discourses of the Buddha. And I was looking, is there anything that the Buddha taught on leadership? So I got to a point, I got to a sutta called the Kutta Danta Sutta. It's Kutta Danta. The Kutta Danta was a Brahmin. Brahmin was the highest caste in the Hindu society. The caste of preachers, priests, and rulers. And this Brahmin called Kutta Danta, he was at his time something like a governor of a very wealthy and fruitful land that belonged into a kingdom, the kingdom of King Senya Bimbisara of Magadha. So don't know exactly where that was.
Northern India, generally speaking.
Okay, so just kind of south of the Himalayas. And this Brahmin was preparing a vast sacrifice of livestock and produce to convince the gods to continue to bless his land and the people. So there's this sacrifice called, what was it called? It's the sacrifice of, where is it?
There's no name there.
Ah, here it's, okay. So basically he's hearing that the Buddha, that the Gautama, the Buddha was Siddhartha Gautama, was the Buddha's given name, and that this he's coming through his town or to a town nearby, and he wants to go and ask him for advice how to do this sacrifice correctly. And it's a little funny because, you know, the Buddha is not known for doing sacrifices, but maybe because he himself comes from a Brahmin family, maybe this other Brahmin thought, okay, maybe he knows something about this. So he wants to go there to see the Buddha, ask him for advice. And he has like a staff of other Brahmins, or maybe a community of other Brahmins around him, who say like, no, you cannot go there. You're way too good for this. He has to come to you. You're the king. He has to come to you, okay? So they mention all kinds of different arguments why he should stay and have the Buddha come to him. So for example, they say, please don't. It's not appropriate for you to go to see the ascetic Gautama, for if you do so, your reputation will diminish and his will increase. For this reason, it is not appropriate for you to go to see the ascetic Gautama. It's appropriate that he comes to see you. They mention a few other things, like, for example, you are well born, like your mother's side is very revered, your father's side. They say he's of pure descent, irrefutable and impeccable. Impeccable. Oh, I like that word. In questions of ancestry, back to the seventh paternal generation. So again, for this reason, it's not appropriate for you to see the ascetic Gautama. It's appropriate for him to come to you. But as it seems, this fellow Kutta Danta was a fairly humble guy. So he's convinced that he should go. He basically lets them speak. He lets them finish their rant on why he shouldn't go. And then he starts his own list of arguments why he should go. And that list is actually way, way longer. It sounds a little bit like, well then, gentlemen, listen to why it's appropriate for me to go to see the ascetic Gautama, and it's not appropriate for him to come to see me. He is well born on both his mother's and father's side, of pure descent, irrefutable and impeccable, questions of answer to the seventh paternal abundant gold coin and bullion stored in dungeons and towers. For this reason, it's not appropriate for the ascetic Gotama to come to see me. Rather, it's appropriate for me to go to see him. He teaches the efficacy of deeds and action. He doesn't wish any harm upon the community of Brahmins. That maybe was a very important point in this position. For this reason, it's not appropriate for the ascetic Gotama to come to see me. Rather, it's appropriate for me to go to see him. So basically, they have a little argument, long lists of arguments, but he ends up going, right? So he gets an audience with the Buddha, private interview, and he asks the Buddha, Master Gotama, I've heard that you know how to accomplish the sacrifice with the sacrifice that they want to do. It's called the sacrifice with 3 modes and 16 accessories. It's not explained anymore what that exactly means, but basically this huge sacrifice to please the gods and keep the land and the people prosperous. So please teach me how to accomplish this sacrifice. Again, this must have been a big thing, this sacrifice. And now the Buddha had always different, he didn't just always teach the same thing in the same way. He tried to do an appropriate teaching to whoever was his target audience. And like a high ranking Brahmin like him, you know, he's probably quite intelligent, well-educated. He decides to tell him a story. And we all like to be taught in stories, right? So I will read that story to you that the Buddha tells to this Brahmin, Kutadanta. By the way, all these, when I'm quoting, when I'm reading, that's from Bhante Sujato's translation of this sutta, which in our handout today, we have the link that you can find.
And it's available on suttacentral.net, which is in the handout, so you can see it there.
Yes. So the Buddha starts the story. Once upon a time, Brahmin, there was a king named Mahavijita. He was rich, affluent, and wealthy, with lots of gold and silver, lots of property and assets, lots of money and grain, and a full treasury and storehouses. Then, as King Mahavijita was in private retreat, this thought came to his mind, I have achieved human wealth and reign after conquering this vast territory. Why don't I hold a large sacrifice that will be for my lasting welfare and happiness? So he summoned the Brahmin high priest and said to him, just now, Brahmin, as I was in private retreat, this thought came to mind. I have achieved human wealth and reign after conquering this vast territory. Why don't I perform a great sacrifice that will be for my lasting welfare and happiness? Brahmin, I wish to perform a great sacrifice. Please instruct me. It will be for my lasting welfare and happiness. When he had spoken, the Brahmin high priest said to him, Sir, the king's realm is harried and oppressed. Bandits have been seen raiding villages, towns, and cities and infesting the highways. But if the king were to extract more taxes while his realm is thus harried and oppressed, he would not be doing his duty. Now the king might think, I'll eradicate this barbarian obstacle by execution or imprisonment or confiscation or condemnation or banishment. But that's not the right way to eradicate this barbarian obstacle. Those who remain after the killing will return to harass the king's realm. Rather, here is a plan relying on which the barbarian obstacle will be properly uprooted. So let the king provide seed and fodder for those in the realm who work in farming and raising cattle. Let the king provide funding for those who work in trade. that the king guarantee food and wages for those in government services. Then the people, occupied with their own work, will not harass the realm. The king's revenues will be great. When the country is secured as a sanctuary, free of being harried and oppressed, the happy people, with joy in their hearts, dancing with children at their breast, will dwell as if their houses were wide open. The king agreed with the high priest's advice and followed his recommendation. So interestingly, here's the concept of the Marshall Plan of 2,500 years ago. So he's basically saying with this story that people in power should be creating access to the right kind of resources that are needed for a prosperous society. They shouldn't fight or, like, you know, imprison or banish or kill, go around. So of course we know material, money, and of course education are resources always needed, and fair wages for those who are in employed positions. We know that education is a big equalizer, and a lot of governments around the world seem to know this already and work hard to level that playing field. We know from, for example, many countries around the world, but for example, Germany, Norway, they have free college education, maybe a small administrative fee, but that's it. In other countries, it's also affordable. Here in this country, I know the Small Business Association gives loans, for example, to create startup capital. And it's not just governments that already take good action. It's nonprofits, for example, here in North Carolina, we have Mountain Bizwork here in the WNC. And we have, for example, NC Idea, who give grants, who give microloans, who give knowledge, know-how about entrepreneurship. And if it's not to be about, not everything is about entrepreneurship, of course, there's a lot needs to be done in education for employed people. And for example, Google just announced, so it's not just nonprofits, but also companies. Google just announced a few days ago, 100,000 scholarships for online certificates in specific areas that, of course, that they need. Workers in data analytics, project management, user experience design, basically to bring, but the aim is not to, the target group is people without college education. Just basically bring them from, I guess, high school level to a certificate level, and make them, for at least for Google, employable. So we know now governments do it, nonprofits do it, companies kind of trying to level the playing field, give fair access. Maybe we can do something too on our individual level. And I'm convinced that we each have our own scope of influence to create peace, not just in us, but around us. I've kind of come up with four things what we could do ourselves. One, we can generously donate to organizations who already help others help themselves. So it could be microloan programs or somehow practical knowledge programs or organizations that give scholarships for educational programs. Number two would be we can buy from companies who we know or provingly pay a fair salary, be it to their employees or be it to their vendors. Topic fair trade, things like that. If it's, fair trade and like kind of, what is that? Living wage salary certified, something like that. Number three, of course, coming up, we can vote for political candidates who think in that way. And number four, maybe we have in our vicinity, we have friends, neighbors, family members that need help. Maybe they're in a disadvantaged situation and we can give direct help of what a seed money for a venture or college fund or something like that. So these are all ways of helping to create inner peace, to create peace on the outside. And we all know that outside piece. If we want to give generously, it starts with within ourselves, and it also is reinforcing itself. Generosity, outward generosity, will create more inner peace for ourselves, and we'll have better meditations. And then basically we have the chance of this figurative mirror that we can look into during meditation, where we have a chance to expand the inner peace. And the more peaceful we are by practicing meditation and every day, every moment awareness, the more we can radiate that peace. And just, that's infectious, right? So with that, may all beings be happy. May all beings be joyful. May all beings be peaceful. May all beings be well. And let's practice meditation now.